is Dr. Pratik Nair. I take a minute to introduce Dr. Nair. Dr. Pratik Nair completed his super speciality training in cardiology at the reputed Southern Railway Hospital, Headquarters Hospital in Chennai. He has vast experience in interventional cardiology, having worked in Railway Hospital, Perambur, and Madras Medical Mission, Frontier Lifeline Hospital, Chettinad Medical College, where he was professor and head of cardiology. He is presently working with Niyaar Hospital, Chennai. Okay. He is a dedicated teacher and has trained more than 30 students in cardiology. He is a fellow of the Royal College of Physicians, Edinburgh and Glasgow, fellow of American Heart Association, American College of Cardiology and International Society of Cardiac Intervention. His main interest areas are interventional cardiology, cardiac failure management, and has over 40 publications in international and national journals. He was awarded Best Doctor Award for his outstanding contribution to the field of medical education in 2012. We take pleasure in inviting him to speak on residual cardiovascular risk.
Thank you, sir, and good evening to all of you. I thank all of you for giving me the privilege of addressing you today. I will be talking on residual cardiovascular risk. Now, there's a lot of controversy. All of us are probably on WhatsApp. We have received a lot of messages that cholesterol is no more dangerous. It's only a business of the companies and the pharma companies and the doctors. They're making money on this. Now, it confused me also. So I have to go a little bit more deeper into what exactly this cholesterol is all about. Now, the reason why there is controversy is, even if there is a normal cholesterol, you can get a heart attack. So that is why this controversy has come up. And now, if you look back, explain. Now, all of us would have seen many presentations on the Jupiter trial on rosuvastatin. It was a landmark trial, and it showed that along with LDL reduction, if you can get hsCRP reduction also, then the maximum benefit is seen in that group, where both LDL and hsCRP, which is a marker of inflammation. So if you have LDL reduced but you have an hsCRP high, then the incidence of heart attacks are higher than if you have both this low. So that is when we realize that there's something more to heart attacks and coronary artery disease than just cholesterol. Then came Bubit, DB22, Aspart LLA, all these trials demonstrated that it's just not LDL. Is something more. It is probably some inflammation that is going on in the body, and there are many causes for that inflammation. It's just not cholesterol. If you go back and see the major cardiovascular events in patients on therapy in statin across all these, if you see, there's a residual risk of nearly 60-70% in all studies. Even with high dose statin, if you manage to get the cholesterol to target levels, there is a 60% chance that you will still get a heart attack. So, of course, the initial euphoria of statins and the amount of reduction of a 30-40% reduction in heart attack, the initial euphoria wore off, and then we realized that there is still another 60% that you need to cover. Now, the Interheart study said that the attributable risk factors for the first myocardial infarction, if you see here, though lipids are the major cause, there are a whole lot of things that can cause heart attacks. Now, why is it? So now what we have here, what we call residual cardiovascular CV risk, is the incident vascular events of progression of established vascular damage persisting in patients treated with current evidence-based recommended care. That is, you use statins, you bring LDL down 70 in patients in secondary prevention, or less than 100 in primary prevention. Despite that, whatever risk, residual risk is there, that is what is called residual cardiovascular risk. So you see here, the 60% residual cardiovascular risk high-dose statins to a patient for prevention of heart attack. Now, we have realized that heart attacks are not only caused by LDLs, it can be caused by anything, any molecules that causes inflammation of the endothelium of the blood vessels, or the coronary vessels, or the cerebrovascular vessels. Atherosclerosis is now considered a complex, multifactorial, progressive disorder in which pro-inflammatory biological pathways promote endothelial dysfunction, local inflammation, favoring vascular wall damage, and developing an atherosclerotic plaque. So it is just not LDL, and it can be anything among the previous list that I showed you. This was a trial, one of the trials, the recent trials. Here what they did, they took interleukin-1b antibody. Interleukin-1b, we are all aware that it's a cytokine, it's an inflammatory mediator. When they suppressed the action of this interleukin-1b in this study, they found that there's a significant reduction in heart attacks, despite no reduction in LDL. This the drug they use, they suppress the action of an inflammatory molecule called interleukin-6, 1b, and it causes reduction in heart attacks, despite no effect on LDL. So this is one of the studies that recently been conducted and it has been published, where we showed that it's inflammation, it can be caused by anything, but LDL also does definitely cause inflammation of the coronary vascular endothelium. Now what can cause inflammation of the endothelium? You see, there's a big list. Can you see? There are so many things. If you give statin, it's just going to look after some of the cholesterol molecules, but it's not going to look after the diabetes, it's not going to look after obesity. Age itself is an inflammatory process. As you grow older, the level of inflammation in your body increases, and age itself is inflammation. So it's very difficult to escape this inflammation and damage to the endothelium. Now coming to LDL cholesterol itself, we think that if we give statins and if we have an LDL of 70, we should not get a heart attack. Now this is what happens. LDL cholesterol underestimates the number of LDL particles. So it depends. Heart attack depends not only on the LDL levels, it also depends on the particle size. If you see here, if the LDL levels are small, LDL particles are small, then they can, they slow plasma clearance, greater artery uptake and retention, causing damage to the endothelium and more particles. So this is seen especially in diabetes. When you have high triglycerides, you will have small, dense LDL particles. And even if you have a LDL level of 70, you are still in danger. You see, now triglycerides. We really do not pay too much attention to triglycerides. Triglycerides are not direct, do not directly damage the endothelium, do not cause inflammation. But what happens is when there are high triglycerides, especially in people with metabolic syndrome, diabetes, the LDL is small particle, small size. So even in a diabetic, your LDL should be much less than 70. You get the point, because particles are so small, it can go into the endothelium, it can get oxidized faster and damage the endothelium. Triglycerides, if you treat triglycerides, now in diabetics, we treat triglycerides with fibrates, Now there are some new other like fish oil and all, like high doses of course, are coming in where you can reduce triglycerides. So along with statins, if you reduce triglycerides along with LDL, the LDL particle size increases and is less harmful to the body. Now the American Dietetic Association has not yet currently recommended reduction of triglycerides as a method to reduce heart attack, because some of the earlier studies in the PEAL trial showed that phenylbutyrates and niacin did not reduce the triglycerides, it did not reduce the event, cardiac events. But recently, the reduced trial presented showed that the use of EPA, that is fish oil, basically fish oil, twice daily, 2 grams twice daily, but a high dose compared to what we were earlier taking, was superior to placebo in reducing triglycerides, cardiovascular events, and cardiovascular deaths among patients with high triglycerides. And 2 more studies, the Strength and Prominence, are going on to see if this reduction of triglycerides with high dose fish oil can be achieved. Now, of course, this is a simple finding. I don't think I'll go to the details, but there was cardiovascular death from MI, all caps of MI, relapse, everything was significantly reduced if you reduce triglycerides. So you have to reduce LDL. You have to reduce the small particle, you have to make LDL large particle compared to the small particle, and you have to reduce triglycerides to get a reduction in cardiac events. Now come to HDL. HDL is protective. Genetically, we are prone to lower HDL levels. Diabetes, metabolic syndrome, or nearly all of us will have metabolic syndrome. After a particular, it's very difficult. Abdominal obesity, some amount of hypertension, some amount of diabetes, cholesterol will be little. So all of us, HDL will be low. This typical opinions. Now what happens is, we've seen that this has been for so many years, nearly more than a decade, we have seen this diagram. If we don't pay attention to this, if the LDL is under control, but the HDL is low, the risk is as good as having a normal HDL and very high LDL. So HDL is also important, the level of HDL is also important. And studies have shown that statin does not, if you have a low LDL and you have a low HDL and you have a low LDL, you should not be happy. Your statins do not protect you against the harmful effects of a low HDL in the body. So that again there's a problem with statins. One, triglycerides does not reduce, and therefore particle size, it does not increase in particle size. Second, the harm of a low HDL level, it cannot treat. So now what we are looking at, when we look at the coronary artery diseases, there is a residual cholesterol risk which we can manage with statins, high-dose statins if necessary, and there is a residual inflammatory risk. So that we have to come up with newer molecules. Now this catechinimab is a new molecule that is coming in, which will help at least some part of it. So many inflammatory mediators. I go back to that slide. See this, any one of this at a level that is not physiological for the body will cause inflammation and can cause a heart attack. So if you see, total cholesterol is only one. You have one advancing age which cannot be controlled with statins, you have diabetes which cannot be controlled with statins, hypertension, kidney disease, cigarette smoking, of course, family history, genetically, hypertension, diabetes, coronary artery disease, all genetically can be genetically transmitted. So all of us should look at our family history. We should see who among our first degree relatives have what diseases, and we must know, we must realize that we run a higher risk of these diseases. If my parents are hypertensive or diabetic, I will definitely get into this problem in due course. The only thing I can do is try to push by adopting a proper lifestyle. If I'm supposed to get diabetes at age 30, I can get it at 50 if I maintain a proper lifestyle. Now the advantage of pushing the onset of disease is that we all know that normally most of these lifestyle disorders take at least 10 years to cause damage. So if I get diabetes at 30, then by 40 I'll have a heart attack. If I get diabetes at 50 or 60, then it's only at 60, 70 that I will get, which is an age that I expect to get into critical issues. So this is the gist of what I wanted to say. That just statins, and that's the controversy, that statins is not, cholesterol is not the cause of heart attack. Definitely cholesterol is a part of heart attack. But then there are so many other causes that even if you control cholesterol, you you can still get into trouble if the other issues are not tackled. So when you are missing FOB, LPA, LPA, lipoprotein little a, these are all, we have got a propensity to have, genetically we are prone to have these molecules within our body, a higher levels compared to the West or even the Far East. And these we don't have any treatment for. So therefore, we have to be, we should not be sanguine saying that my cholesterol is very normal, therefore I may not get an attack. That's what I wanted to say with my talk today. I think that's about it. Thank you for your patience. Any questions? I'll be
ready. Measures for measuring the small dense LPA?
Yeah, small dense, see, it's not done in all labs. It's not done commercially. It's more of a laboratory. So this is a problem. In due course, maybe someone will come up with a commercially available test kit for LDL particle size. So right now, we are still vulnerable to. The only thing we can do is try to keep our triglycerides low, which will automatically increase the size of.
What is the optimal LDL?
See, it's coming now. Even in fact, we are changing it. See, the basic physiology is the cell. The myocardial cell, as soon as the LDL level in the blood goes above 40, the receptors turn inside into the cell, so that it cannot take it anymore. It doesn't need the myocardial cells don't need any more LDL. So what that LDL is moving out, the blood gets oxidized and it causes that. So that is the physiology. So we think that that will be the actual. The studies are now showing that now the current recommendation is. For primary or secondary prevention, you should bring the LDL less than 55. The current less than 55. Now, see, I
now see. HDL then.
HDL, of course, it's very difficult to bring up HDL. LDL, we can bring it down. And for primary prevention, less than 100. Less than 100.
Right now,
sir,
HDL increase,
other than
walking, exercise.
Exercise, I think sometimes, niacin and all are good, but then there's such high doses, very difficult. And maybe
it's not a good
plan.
Yeah. But
that guy say HDL is not very good.
Thank you very much, sir.
What is the role of oxidizing the cholesterol? They say oxidizing
the cholesterol is bad. See, LDL, if remained too much, too long in the stream, it gets oxidized automatically. And that is what causes damage. Oxidized LDL is the damage. Similarly for glucose, then it glycated albumin, glycated hemoglobin. These are agents. So if glucose or LDL does not get oxidized, then there is no problem. But it gets oxidized, it will remain too long.
How to decrease the oxidation?
Decrease the LDL.
LDL.
They say oxidase is cholesterol. No, that's difficult. Oxidase is part of the inflammatory process that you are in. So that is difficult. Unless you, see, that's why yoga and meditation is very helpful. In these stresses, reduce the inflammation. See, the older systems, now we are realizing how useful it is compared to the allopathic medicine.
They say in the nutrition book, they say grape seed extract is the most.
Yeah, these are antioxidants.
Antioxidants.
Yeah, these are anti-inflammatory antioxidants. Grape seed extract. So many other things are added. Vitamin E, vitamin C, these are all.
I think there are no mark that it is
Thank you very much.
Thank you.